there's risk in, you know, in driving and in other sports. Of course, there's a little more risk in climbing. I mean, I can't deny that. But for me, the risk I'm taking is worthwhile for what I get from climbing. You know, I've soloed climbs for the last 25 years and I haven't got hurt.
Des messages de condoléances d'un peu partout dans le monde arrivent aux proches d'un alpiniste d'Hawkesbury.
We've got more details tonight about the avalanche that killed world-class ice climber Guy Lacelle. He was taking part in an ice climbing event earlier today at Grotto Falls.
Okay, go ahead and tell me your name and if you've ever been to the festival before. And...
My name is Guy Lacelle and I was there 2 years ago. And I missed last year because I had surgery, but I'm back this year. Looking forward to it.
So, is it going to be fun climbing all this stuff?
No, it's going to be horrible. I'm going to hate every second of it.
Of course it's going to be fun. It's just kidding.
You know, you think about this person who's done these incredible, incredibly amazing solos over the course of his life. And to be caught by something that just happened out of nowhere and could have happened to anybody in that moment. It had nothing to do with anything about his skill or his history or his faith in his sport. It was just something that happened.
He's climbed more ice than any human that ever walked the planet. I mean, at all levels, at all grades, he's climbed probably in more places.
So we start tomorrow with one. We have 10 days left. We do one every day until we're totally dead.
Yeah. No more rest days.
Guy fell into the tree planting world, and that was his way to give back. He gave back more than he'll ever know to a lot of us. But for Guy, inside his soul, it was the tree planting, and he committed his life to it. Most people tree plant for a season or two, and they're in it for the money. Guy, though, there was no other way for him. Because it was more than just a lifestyle, it was something he'd give to the world.
He always did everything right for the trees, because as a planter, I mean, these were lives. That's the way he always viewed, and that was always what was conveyed to his crew, that these are lives.
It's also a good lifestyle, you know, it's a good job. Like, I always feel good about planting trees. You know, I went to university, I could have done other things, but it just seems that that was more fitting for me to just be out in the woods most of the time and, you know, planting trees is a good feeling. It gives me freedom too, like in the winter, I make enough money doing this job that in the winter I can go climbing.
I can't even remember meeting Guy because he was just always around. He was Guy, he was ice climber extraordinaire. He was the hardest of the hard, and he was always around. He's just one of those people in climbing that is just there. You know, it's sort of like spring. Oh, there's Guy. It must be winter.
I think Guy discovered early on that ice climbing was an outlet for his athletic gumption that he had. I mean, he was one of the best athletes when he was young. He could do 10 one-arm pull-ups with either arm. You know, he was a Canadian champion, I think, of the 400 meter snowshoe race.
I think he told me once that he ran the 400 in like 48 seconds or something like that. I mean, he was, you know, a super fast runner. I mean, he's quite the athlete. And so he had like this kind of this blue collar side and then the jock side. He played basketball and football and then this ice climbing and tree planting. Really, I would say I knew him more as a tree planter than I did as a climber. And so that's what kind of stayed with me for a long time, and then eventually we reconnected through climbing.
Actually, my father used to cut trees. He was a foreman for a logging industry, and when I was really small, I remember him saying that every time he was cutting a tree or one of his workers was cutting a tree, he felt a little sad that he would have liked to see that tree back. So. I think for me to be planting a lot of trees now sort of makes a full circle.
People knew that it was good to plant for Guy. He had a reputation for being, yeah, pretty demanding in terms of quality. He expected you to work really well, but on the other hand, I think that everybody that planted for him recognize that that was going to be good for them as well.
Yeah, he had actually thought that he was going to be a phys ed teacher, and then while he was doing that degree, then he found climbing, and that was it. You know, that was it.
And then you can even start right of it,
yeah,
on the ice, and then traverse where it's flat, and then go up. You know, if the ramp looks like a lot of snow and, you know, not so much fun, you think on the steep ice it'd be more fun.
Yeah.
He would have a vision of something, and he wouldn't let the idea get in his mind that it couldn't be done. At least not without trying it. I can remember him looking at this overhanging icicle and saying, "David, can we climb that?" And I said, "Maybe you can, but no. We don't do that." And in those days, we didn't climb overhanging icicles. We'd climb around it, we'd climb bulges, but we didn't go up big daggers. And sure enough, that's now a standard route down there with some mixed rock underneath it. And his vision of someday we'll climb that came true.
Well, originally I started ice climbing with a friend that I'd been rock climbing with, and he really liked it, and I tried it, find it a little different. It's harder to start ice climbing than rock climbing. It's not as natural. Got the crampons, the ice tool. But once I got used to it, I realized that I really liked it and was pretty proficient at it. But way back then, we didn't have very good ice screws. They didn't work very well. They were hard to place. So I start naturally running out the steep section because it was so strenuous to put the ice screws, and realized I was pretty comfortable doing that. And I think from there evolved soloing sort of in a natural way.
For him, I think that climbing ice was kind of like a kid climbing a tree. You know, kid is not going to pull out rope and gear and stuff like that. He just climbs a tree, and that seems to me like Guy, that's kind of the way he climbed.
He didn't need to speak about what he did. For him, and I think that was part of the discipline, is that, I mean, we all have egos, and, you know, of course you want to do really well at what you do best, but he really didn't want it to be a part of the ultimate process of when he was on the ice climb, I don't think.
There's hardly a single area in the world that he didn't ice climb. And, you know, he had the list of 100, his 100 favorite ice climbs. And people have made careers out of climbing a third of those climbs, you know, and Guy did them all.
What was cool about Guy is that he just lived and did his thing and was excited and got after it. He wasn't a legend in his own mind. He just did stuff, and I like that.
It's even better to do that route with you two. It makes a fantastic route memorable to have done it with the two of you. It's so fun to be up there with you guys. Even me, I will remember this day. You forget everything.
I find myself, my attitude and my way of being is more dynamic. Being with young tree planter or young climbers, and I actually don't feel that far apart from them.
People thought of him often as an extremist. Intensity is very different from being an extremist. What was extreme for him, he'd back off of. He had no problems going home. It took a lot to convince him that he couldn't do something or that it wasn't in shape to climb, but he could back off.
He had a very good sixth sense about things. He really did, and he was quiet enough internally to be able to really listen to it.
I think he was very much aware of the possible consequences of what he was doing, and that the game for him was to try and both measure those consequences accurately and still play at the high level that he was playing. And keeping it pure that way was absolutely fundamental to who he is.
I don't think I understood that need to be in that place. I respected it, and I knew that the result of all of that is what I got in terms of his character. You know, everything that happens there, he would bring back to me in a different format.
Guy was an incredibly fun guy to go climbing with, both because he really, truly loved it deep down in his soul, but also because he was just a very funny man. So every day going climbing with him would be joke after joke after joke.
Hello, my name is Audric Ariapi, and I'm a hot climbing chick from Quebec, and I would like to say that nowadays women, we climb almost as well as the men. Actually, we climb as well as the men. Oh, fuck it, let's be honest. We climb better than the men. We also have more hair and we look a lot better. See?
Hello.
Hello, I'm Guy Lacelle, blah, blah, blah.
Not only did he have aliveness like you rarely find in people, you felt better being around him, felt stronger, a better climber, a better person.
Yeah, there was no person that I could imagine trusting more than I trusted Guy. He was absolutely there for you all the time.
You gotta be kidding. You know, I don't think I cried for 24 hours because it... You know, what do you do with that? You know, I think your mind just... Yeah, what do you do with that? I know the first thing that came across my mind when it was happening, when he was still conscious, he would say, Marge, I'm really sorry. I know that would be the first thing he would think is, I'm just really sorry.
It was pretty small in terms of avalanche size. It's probably maybe a foot deep or maybe even less than that. I don't exactly know. He was in one of the constrictions in the gully, so he kind of had nowhere to go. We just carried him over some cliffs.
The sadness for him would not be what happened to him, but rather what it was going to do, particularly to Marge and to his family.
Well, love is a mystery. I'm not sure anybody can answer questions why you love somebody. I think what bonded us was our hearts, for sure, and how we wanted to be in the world and care for the people in our lives.
You don't lose people like Guy, other than the physical part of it. And I'm bummed, I'm sad. He's like a little brother to me, and I want to go play. But I didn't lose him, you know. He's there constantly.
The thing about Guy and the Bozeman competition, he loved that competition. That was pure Guy, the way that competition was set up, in that it was natural climbing in a natural environment, open form so that people could just go and do what they wanted to do. It felt more, in his own words, like a day of climbing rather than a competition.
He brought life to everyone around him. He brought a certain, he's just the guy you wanted to be with all the time.
You know, one thing I really like is the fact that even though he was a climber, that's not the stories people are telling. They're telling the human stories about the lovely human being he was. And I don't know, that just says it all to me, is that that's how people are left.
I wish the young crowd of new climbers could have been around a guy like that, because he's to a climber, to a human being. It's just a perfect role model of how to be real.
Self-confidence is the most valuable gift a man can possess, but it's not a gift freely granted. The blindly arrogant possess it least of all. To possess this true confidence, it's necessary to have learned to know oneself at moments when one was standing on the very frontier of things, times when one could even take a glance over to the other side. And then one had to examine oneself with unsparing clarity to establish what one felt, thought, and did at each such a moment.
Around my legs, but it's all